gone through the yesterday's material once again, and hope things are clear yesterday.
Yes, sir.
Sir.
So today I'll take you through the t-test and ANOVA, and also the multiple discriminant analysis. So before we get in there, just spend some time on what kind of t-test we'll be doing. So a little bit of that was already explained to you yesterday. So quickly we will review that and we'll get into the t-test. So we start with a basic question: why do we need a t-test? And like we told you yesterday, when you are dealing with parametric data, in order to test the hypothesis of differences, please remember t-test falls under testing tools that are used to test the hypothesis of differences, not hypothesis of association. So we'll not be commenting whether two things are related or not, things like that. We'll be always looking at two populations or one population and commenting on the variable concern. So broadly, there are two types of t-tests. We call one sample t-test and two sample t-test. And the two sample t-tests are further divided into independent sample t-test and dependent sample t-test, which we called yesterday paired sample t-test. There is a very narrow difference between paired and dependent, but most of the time they can be used interchangeably. Now look at in a one sample t-test, what we do is we see collect data regarding a particular population through a sample. So we can as well take our yesterday's example of whether the mean salary of the 2020 batch out MBA students first salary is actually gone beyond 2 lakhs. That's also a case where you can use a one sample t-test. So to answer such questions, we take the sample and we calculate its mean. Through that, we're going to test whether the population mean equals a particular number, like yesterday's case, 2 lakhs, is more than 2 lakhs or less than 2 lakhs. So here, I gave you another example. Say HR department is taking a satisfaction survey of its employees. The data being collected from a sample of 200 employees out of 2000 total employees. So the 2000 total employees is our population. Out of that, 200 employees are being surveyed. So if the data was collected on a scale of 1 to 5, the department may be curious to know whether the average satisfaction score equals 4. So they might well be expecting that it should be 5, but the test here is that whether it is equal to 4, right? But the case is we often test this to see whether the population has benefited by an intervention. That means you can actually run a training program for a set of your employees and see whether their performance has improved after the training program. Or you can give a diet exercise to a set of your customers and see whether weight has been reduced after the diet exercise. But to answer that, we should be requiring the entire population's parameters prior to this intervention. So the intervention could be a training program, the intervention could be a diet exercise, or the intervention could be any other, a motivation class, or the intervention could be, reducing of, work hours, whatever it may be. So the final question is whether the population mean equals a number, or it is more than a number, or it is less than a number, is the appropriate setting where we use the one sample t-test. Right. So Now, let us take an example. Last year, the performance of students in a school final examination averaged 60 out of 100. This is for the entire population. In order to improve the score, the administration has conducted a special training program for the students during the current year. Now, the administration wants to know whether the average would have changed from 60. I mean, basically, they are looking at whether it should have improved beyond 60. That means if I conduct the same test now, if we go for the school final this year, then we should be actually getting the average score as more than 60. That is the objective with which last year they took up a training program. Now, to test this, the district administration took a sample of 51 students and noted their scores. Right. Now, this is how we'll be able to test the hypothesis. One is state the hypothesis and select an alpha level. Here, alpha level is the significance level that we have discussed yesterday. As I told you, the significance level is basically the risk that you are willing to take regarding your decision being wrong of rejecting H0. So in most of the cases, we would like to reject H0. So because the rejection, H0 is a status quo, right? We always want our intervention to bring in some change. We always want our actions to produce results. So basically, in a setup like this, the expected outcome is to reject H0. But then we set a level, because if you want to be 100% sure that you should not make any wrong decision, then you have to do the complete enumeration. That means you have to study the whole population. Then only you can be sure that whatever is the result that you are turning out is 100% true. In all other cases where you have a sample and where using the sample statistic or using the sample average, you are commenting on the population average. In all such cases, right, you should specify some alpha level. You should be willing to take a little bit of risk. Then only the statistical procedures allow you to do that. Otherwise, you have an option of going with entire population enumeration. So we'll have to decide at what percentage risk that I'm willing to accept. And based on that, you would actually locate what is called as critical region. I'll take you through that in a little while from now. And calculate the test statistic. Here it is the t-test. So you'll calculate t value and you decide regarding H0. Just keep this framework in mind and let me take you through that. So now state the hypothesis and select an alpha level. This is where we are with respect to the example that we have discussed just now. So in our example, what we're trying to do, we want to see whether the mu is still 60 or it is changed. So we set up the H0 and H1, that is the null and alternative. So the H0 says the mu is 60. That means there is no change in the performance. So this year students also will be getting the same 60 marks as the average mark in the school final examination. That is one statement. And alternatively, we are thinking that no, it would have been really different. But please note, for time being, I'm not saying mu is greater than 60. I'm only saying mu is not equal to 60. So we'll just go and see what happens if H1 is mu is greater than 60, right? Just wait for a while, I'll clarify that. So, but notice that the alternative is mu is not equal to 60. And once you have that, we'll go and do, but otherwise you could have stated the H0 like this. That means, mu less than or equal to 60, that is no upward change in the performance, or mu is greater than 60, that is there is an upward change in the performance. This is called, a test for positive effect. And if there's a test for negative effect, sometimes negative does not mean negative in, statistics, because we don't take a test for negative effect. Here, negative effect means sometimes the underlying variable is expected to reduce its quantity. For example, you are talking about a exercise and weight reduction scenario. You are talking about some economic scheme and poverty reduction scenario. You are talking about some intervention in the market and price reduction scenario. Then reduction there means either cost reduction or price reduction or poverty reduction. These all are positive only. But statistically, they'll have, the opposite of what the positive effect. But negative doesn't mean negative there. So the other downside we call. So in that case, what we say, the H0 says there is no downward change in the performance, whereas mu is less than 60. That means there is downward change in the performance. Yeah. So now, let us get into this language of two-tailed test and one-tailed test. You are aware when your alternative is mu not equal to 60, this is called a two-tailed test. That means we are just looking for, just give me a second. Yeah, so you guys are aware of the two-tailed versus one-tailed test. That in a two-tailed test we'll have both the ends of the distribution open, in which case it is a change in the performance versus no change in the performance. But in a one-tailed test we would look for the direction of the change. Either you look for an upward change or look for a downward change. Is this points clear as of now? See, you are at will and freedom to just stop me as and when you are not understanding. As I believe that you would have been aware of this, I am going a little faster today. Is the pace at which we are going okay? You are able to follow me or are there any issues?
No, sir, we continue. You can continue, we are.
Yeah, thank you. Now, this is about the one-tail and two-tail test. Now, let us start with the two-tail test, then I'll also show you how it will be different when you go to the one-tail test. In a two-tail test, look at the alternative. The alternative is non-directional. That means it is not equal to 60. So when it is greater than or less than, then we say it is directional test. And then we'll set the level of significance, that is your alpha level, at 0.05. Remember, this is the first step in hypothesis testing. When I go to the second step, you locate the critical region. The critical region is the region where if the calculated value falls, you reject the H0, right? So to identify the critical region, you need to know, let us say for a t-test, the degrees of freedom, which is n minus 1. So where n is the sample size. So here our n is 51. 51 minus 1 is 50. So that is your degrees of freedom. Now you look into a t distribution table, you look at 50, that is the degrees of freedom, and you look at the level of significance, 5%. So you see that as 2.009. So this is called what is called a critical t value or table t value. Now I think I have a graph to present to you. If you put this graph on the critical value on a graph sheet, it looks something like this. You know that the middle point corresponds to the mean, and towards your right you have 2.009, and towards your left you have minus 2.009 for the level of significance that you have set, that is 5% and 50 degrees of freedom. Now, the critical region is also called as rejection region. Now, we'll go and calculate our t statistic. Once you calculate your t statistics, if the t statistic falls in the critical region or rejection region, which means if it is going to be more than 2.009 or going to be less than minus 2.009, then it is falling in the critical region. So then we will be rejecting our H0. And remember, such rejection is having a 5% risk. That is the significance level. Now you calculate the test statistic. To calculate this test statistic, what we will have to do? You first obtain your sample mean of your 51 students. Let's say it happened to be 63. And then you look at the standard deviation, that is 9.27. So once you have this, then you estimate what is called the standard error. So standard error of the distribution of sample means for a t statistic is s by root n, right? So s is the sample standard deviation, which is 9.27 divided by square root of 51 is 1.30. And then why you need this 1.30? Because this t statistic uses x bar minus mu divided by s x bar. That is the standard error. Now 63 minus 60 divided by 1.30, then the value of t is 2.31. The value of the t is 2.31. And where is this falling? This is falling in the critical region. That means the 2.31 is more than 2.009. So what is our decision? Our decision is to reject H0 and conclude that the population mean is significantly different from 60. That means it is not equal to 60. Either it is more than 60 or it is less than 60. It is not equal to 60, which translated into some English conclusion is the special training program had an effect on the marks scored by the students this year. This is how we do it in the traditional method of statistics using statistical tables and manual calculations. But today, as you are aware, we have the SPSS software available. So what I propose now is to run the same test using the SPSS software and see how the SPSS software procedure is different from the normal procedure that we have gone ahead with. Okay, let me open the SPSS file that I have. In the meantime, you can just think about if you have had any questions.
No, sir, not now.
Yeah. It's taking some time to load. Just I think it's not running, that's the problem. Okay, I'm sorry about it. It has been quite some time. I didn't check it on this system. Yeah, rather I'll show you what is happening. So this is how we open an SPSS file of let us say one sample t-test. See what you see the marks in the current year. So you are able to hear the sound also as well.
Yes, sir.
Then I think we will use this file. Let me increase the volume. So if you are able to hear it, it's perfect. So it's as good as.
Sir, actually only you are audible, not files volume.
This volume is not audible?
No, sir, only you are audible.
Then it's fine. So what I'll do, I will then just speak for myself.
Yes, sir.
Voice over, okay.
Yes.
Yeah, so now this is where you go. And if you see the numerical, the variable view of the data, see, this is the data that we have. Once you go to the variable view of the data, it is going to show us how this variable has been defined in SPSS. So you have only one variable. You see, it is named as marks current year. So so what we're trying to test here is H naught is mu equal to 60. H alternative is mu is not equal to 60.
Sir, you are not audible properly. Your voice is fluctuating, sir.
Pardon?
Your voice is fluctuating, sir.
Fluctuating. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Is it okay now? Am I audible now?
Now it is okay, but after some second, your voice is gone, sir.
No. I don't think it will go now. Okay.
Sir, please check your network also. There is a problem. There might be a problem in at your end. Sir is audible.
Yeah. Yeah, now you see, this is how we go into the, SPSS dialog box. See, you go to analyze, then pick up, compare means, then go to one sample t-test, right? Then go and select this variable called marks in current year into, actually it's already selected. If it were in the left-hand side box, yeah, this is how it will be normally. Then you take this into right-hand side box. Yeah, once you have taken this into right-hand side box, now you see this is important. So the test value, that is the test value is, what is that you are actually hypothesizing? So you have to enter here your null hypothesis value. So the null hypothesis tells us that H naught, that mu is equal to 60. So this is what I am testing for, right? So your test value, you enter 60. then you can go to options. So here you can give the confidence interval percentage, but this is not required unless you are statistically little more sound and you want to see the estimates of the lower and upper limits of the estimates. You will have to go for that. Otherwise, normally the kind of research that we do, which is more applied research, will not be using this option. So you can leave it blank, doesn't matter. Then go and click OK. See, this simple. Now, in our slide show that I have shown you, you see there are four steps. First step is state your hypothesis and set an alpha level. Second step is go and identify the critical region. So then the third step is, based on the critical region, they calculate the test statistic. Then fourth step is decide about H0. These are the four steps that I have taken you through in the PowerPoint presentation. But here all this happens in a single step in SPSS. The only thing that I have entered is, after I have selected the variable, the only thing that I have entered is what? In H0, what is the mu value? That is 60. That is the only thing I have entered. Now, based on data, it has picked up the number of data points, that is the sample size. You get it as 51. Then it has calculated the mean of the data, right? So the mean of the data happens to be 63, right? Then you see it has also calculated standard deviation, that is 9.26, and the standard error of the mean, right? This one, you see, you have calculated as S by square root of N. So that has already been calculated as 1.29. Just have a look at these two tables. Again, I'll take you back through the PowerPoint presentation. There you see all these values again. So I'll just stop this for a while and then take you through. See this table, which is called one sample statistics. Now, how does they compare in our thing? Here. Yeah. So this is 1.30. It has calculated this as 9.27. Then square root of 51, this is 1.30. So that's what you see here as 1.298, which is nothing but, when rounded off, it is 1.20. This is the standard error. Then it has calculated the T statistics you see here. So the T statistics is 2.31. So here, to calculate the T statistic, we'll have to follow this formula. 63 minus 60 divided by standard error, it is 2.31. OK. After this has been calculated, now here is the question, that based on the T value, we have decided whether it is falling in the critical region, that is the rejection region, or not. But here we don't have an alpha level set. The 95% confidence interval, as I told you, is something that you need not actually care for now, because it is for people who are into a little bit of more statistics for them to see. Now, you see the mean difference. Mean difference means the hypothesized value of our mean is 60, but the mean of the actual sample is 63. So there is a difference of 3. Now, based on this 3 mean difference, the researcher has to decide whether a difference of 3 in the mean is large enough to say that there was an impact. That is the question actually we are answering. So had the mean difference been 1, that means had I got the mean of my sample as 61, would I have concluded the same? Is a different question. So that is why the mean difference value is thrown out by SPSS output. Now the most important part is, then how do I decide whether I am rejecting H0 or not? Like I told you yesterday, always the decision is to reject H0, especially when you're using SPSS. The SPSS package is built such a way, you first propose to reject H0. So yes, I am rejecting H0, but ask this question, at what risk you are rejecting H0? That risk is given here in the form of p value. The significance value that is shown here as two-tailed is called 0.05 p value. Now I am taking a risk of 2.5% when I am concluding that the mean score is significantly different from 60. Is this risk acceptable to me? Yes, this risk is acceptable to me because I have set my alpha level to be 5%, 0.05. So I conclude to reject H0 and conclude that the training program in fact would have had an impact on the performance of the students. So this is how you do it in SPSS and differently from your the manual calculation. Now tell me, you have understood the manual calculation. I've shown it in 4 steps, then I've shown it in SPSS. Are you in a position to interpret and appreciate the process that we need not calculate the t value, we need not calculate the mean and standard deviation, and we are not required to calculate the standard error of the mean? All these calculations are done automatically by SPSS. That is advantage number one. But the difference is, unlike the manual hypothesis testing, where you first decide your alpha level, in SPSS, the alpha level need not be decided. So once you get this p value, only thing is you'll have to check the risk. I have named it as risk of rejecting true H0, RORTHO. So your risk of rejecting true H0 is 2.5%. So if you have accepted for a level of 5%, 2.5% is below 5%. So you can say H0 is rejected at 5%. Is this clear? Any questions here, either on the manual process or on the SPSS process?
Yes, sir.
So may I speak?
Yeah, please.
Sir, while doing manual calculations and by using SPSS, there is sometimes little variation in the answer. Is it correct that there is some variation or there is mistake on my part?
No, see, the variation is in manual calculations, if you take up to 4 decimals. See, for example,
yes, sir,
it is showing this value 1.298, but in manual calculation, we said it's 1.3.
Yes, sir.
So if you show up to 4 decimals, there will not be any variation.
Okay, sir.
So whether you do it manually, when you are doing it manually, always maintain 4 decimals.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Then it will tally with SPSS always.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Sir, can you please explain the rejection and acceptance on SPSS as you tell the 0.025? And mean difference is 3.
No, mean difference, let us not worry. That is only for your understanding. I told you have to decide. First thing is you are rejecting H0. Okay.
Okay, sir.
That, but at what is the risk? 2.5%. Now you should ask, is this 2.5% acceptable to me? It depends on what is the significance level you are desiring. See, if your significance level, if alpha is 5%, then the p-value, that is 0.025, that's 2.5%, is less than 5%. Then you can as well reject H0 comfortably. But if the significance value happened to be 6%, let us say it came out at 0.06, then you are not rejecting H0 in this case. You reject H0 when your p value, that is significance value as shown by SPSS, is less than your alpha. Alpha is something you have to decide. Generally, we take alpha of 1%, 5%, and 10%.
In the normal distribution table, that is in diagram, we compare 2.31, matlab t value, we will take t value, na?
Yeah, t value is 2.31. This is compared with 2.00.
And that 2.31, we will take and compare it from 2.008 in this table.
Yes.
In SPSS, we generally take
Yes,
and in the table. Take 0.025. 2.009.
So if your calculated t value is more than this, okay, then you reject H naught at 5%.
Yes, yes, yes.
Calculated t value should be more than the table value to reject H naught.
Sure. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Any questions here? See,
these are similar. Calculated value if greater than table value, then we reject. And another thing is, if p value is small,
less than alpha.
Less than, smaller than alpha, yes, significance level, we also reject. These two things are similar.
Yes. Okay.
Ji, sir.
Yeah. Now, but like I've told you, the directional hypothesis. See, we are not interested in just knowing that the performance has changed, but we are more interested in knowing whether it has changed in the positive direction. We are more interested in knowing whether the performance has improved after the training program. So such things are called the directional hypothesis here. You see, this mu is greater than 60. But when you do it manually, what you do, it is very simple. If you are doing this hypothesis manually, then you only see whether your calculated t is more than 2.009, only this direction. If that is somewhere, if the calculated t value is minus, then you are not interested in that. See, in a two-tailed test like this, what we are going to reject H naught if t is more than 2.009 or even if it is less than minus 2.009. Yes or no? Now, what does this mean? The rejection region. The calculated t should be either more than 2 or it should be less than minus 2. In both the cases, you reject H naught and conclude that the training program had an impact. You don't know and you don't want to conclude what kind of impact. But if you just wanted in a one-tail test, that you are interested only in a one-tail test, or a one-tail test like this, the rejection region will be only this. You are not bothered about this. Yeah, this is the entire thing is, fail to reject H naught. Only this portion you reject H naught. This is for this test. Let me just rather put here like this. If this is our hypothesis, then this becomes our rejection region. Now try to understand this. Mu greater than 60, because of this, now I have removed this. On the other hand, if you have another directional test, say for example, now you wanted to say the mu is less than 60. Now I'm changing it. So here it is greater than or equal to 60. If this is the case, then your rejection region will be different. Then you will not have this region. Please remember this. So you reject H naught if it falls anywhere here. Throughout. So in this case, this is your fail to reject H naught. See, are you in a position to appreciate the difference between one-tailed test and two-tailed test? Is it clear?
Yes, sir, but please can you repeat the one tail test when mu is greater than less than concept?
Yeah, this is a one tail test when mu is greater than 60. When mu is greater than 60, what is happening? My rejection region is only on the right side. I want to see if my T is more than 2. If I get a T less than 2 or 0 or minus, then I fail to reject H0. Right? When my alternative is mu is less than 60, that means I am looking for a downward change. Let us say weight reduction, etc., those cases. Then this entire region becomes the fail to reject H0. Then I would only reject H0 if my T is less than minus 2. If it is minus 1 or 0 or 1, 2, 3, 4, then I fail to reject H0. Whereas in a two-tail test, you reject H0 when your T is either less than minus 2 or it is more than 2. Because here your alternative is just that mu is not equal to 60.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
You got this?
Yes, sir.
Or maybe I can do one more help to all of you, that of putting all three in one diagram. Then you would understand. See, so this is a case of this is casing. This is case 2. Now look at these three things, it's very easy for you to understand. So here, in the first case, so here this is mu is equal to 60. Here we're testing for mu not equal to 60. This is mu greater than 60. Yeah, this first instance it will be difficult, but once you understand that, it will be easy. Now you see these three different diagrams, then you will understand how to reject or how to accept. So in this case, H0 is rejected when T is less than minus 2.009 or t is greater than 2.009. This is the first case. Right? Control C. Here, H naught is rejected when when t is greater than 2.009. In this case, H naught is rejected when t is less than 2.009. Now this should be clear to all of you. Now just have a look at this. So this is how the first one is the two-tailed test, the other two are one-tailed tests. Hope this should be clear now.
Yes sir, totally clear.
So now let us move forward. So now we did not invest our time discussing about this again and again. When you get into SPSS, in SPSS we don't have a one-tailed test. That's the problem. So if you see in the one sample t test, it is always two-tailed, or any t test is two-tailed. Then how do I solve my problem? If my hypothesis is directional, that means I have a one-tailed test, then it's very simple. You divide this p-value into 50%. You make it half. Even if you have a directional hypothesis, you would still do the same procedure, but make your t-value half. Are you understanding this? In SPSS, you don't have an option of having a one-tailed test. So you please make a note this point, okay? So now then let us get into what are the, independent samples t-test. So we use an independent samples t-test to check for the equality of means of two populations, whether two populations have got the same mean. So you take a country like India and you take a country like Germany, and maybe you wanted to see whether the employment rate is same in these two countries. So you are testing whether the employment rate in country one, that is India, is equal to employment rate in country two. It may be Germany, XYZ. So that is the test. So the null hypothesis says that mu one is equal to mu two. That means employment rate in these two countries are same. And alternative says it is not equal to. It is not equal to. So then what you do? You pick up one sample from India, another sample from Germany, and you calculate what is the X1 bar. That is for Indian population, Indian sample, and X2 bar for the German population. Then you can actually see how it can be done. But I'll not be getting into the statistical procedure of the four steps. We'll straight away jump into SPSS. Now, where do we use the independent sample t-test? You can compare two countries' employment rate. You can compare two countries' inflation. You can compare two states' crime rate. You can compare two different training methods, two different treatments, two different drugs, how they are working, two different interventions in general. Or you can have it in two different geographies, that means two different cities, states, or nations, right? You can also compare under two different climatic conditions. You have one crop in one climatic condition, another crop in another climatic condition, and whether these two climatic conditions yield the same crop. Or you can compare it between two organizations, two schools, right, to universities, to companies, etc. Now let us take an example. In this example, we have a study of motivation in two companies. So I will explain it through the spaces. Right, to study this, the hypothesis is that there is no difference between the motivation levels of employees in company one and the same in company two. That means company one's employees are as good, as motivated as company two employees, right? So this is the test. But to do this, what you do, you take one sample from company one, you take another sample from company two, and that the way you are taking sample from company one is not dependent on the way you are taking sample from company two. That's why it is called as independent samples t-test. Now let us get into the spaces. So here we go. We have a respondent ID, right? That is, you can call it employee ID or some kind of identification of the employee. And then there are two companies. We have company one and company two. Here is company one. Where you go, you will get company two. And there's only one variable, that is motivation. Now look at the variable who. The respondent ID is defined as a nominal variable. You remember yesterday we discussed nominal, interval, and scale. Right, this is just an identification number and is defined as nominal variable. And company is also a nominal variable because either it is company one or company two. So one for company one and two for company two. That is just a code that could have been reversed or it could have been even AB. Then motivation is defined as a scale. That means it's a numerical variable. So our idea is to see whether the average motivation score of employees in company one is same as the average motivation score of employees in company two. For this, we will run the independent samples t-test, go to analyze. Running pretty slow, I think, video. Go to compare means, then go to independent samples t-test. And remember, take the motivation, that is the test variable. And we have a grouping variable. Grouping variable is where we have defined who belong to what company. And you have to take the grouping variable and you should tell spaces that the group one is identified with numerical one and group two with numerical two. If you have used a different code like A and B, we would have told group one is identified as A and group two is identified as B. Go to options. Like I told you, you can leave it as it is. Click OK. Now you see, it is giving you the group statistics. You have two companies, company one and company two. And in company one, you took a sample of 81 and in company two, 94. Remember, this is one way you can differentiate between one sample and two sample two test. Sorry, independent sample and dependent sample two test. In case of independent sample two test, the sample sizes can be different. They need not be same. Whereas in dependent sample, because it's only one sample, it has to be same. And it has calculated the mean of motivation score in company one happened to be 4.25, in company 3.7, then of course the standard deviations are given. You look at the standard deviations, they're similar, they're kind of very, very same. Then basically one of the reasons with which you do for this test is that there is an assumption that the underlying population's variances are same. That is an assumption. To test this assumption, the SPSS does what is called as Levine's test for equality of variances. Levine's test for equality of variances. The null hypothesis is that the variances are equal. The variances are equal. First, it will test for that and see, look at the significance level. The significance level shows 0.795. So 0.795 is pretty much above the acceptable level of significance, which is generally 0.05. So you fail to reject H naught. That means the equal variances are there. So based on this interpretation, you'll have to look at which of these two t tables. This is one t table. This is another t table. Now that my Levine's test for equality of variance is telling me that variances are equal. Variances are equal in the underlying data. Even if you see the standard deviation figures there, 0.6123 and 0.62, they're almost close. So SPSS is telling me that the underlying population's variances are same. So then I will use the first row. First row, that means I will use the T value as 5.8 and degrees of freedom as 173 and significance level as 0.000. But luckily in this case, even if the equal variances are not assumed, because in both the cases your significance levels are almost zero, it doesn't make any big challenge for you to actually reject your H naught. Reject your H naught and say that the motivation levels of the employees in the two companies are significantly different. That means in company one, the motivation level is high. In company two, the motivation level is low. Is this understood? Any questions?
Sir,
yeah.
I have one question.
Please?
Sir, it was a basic question. In slide, it was written that motivation was measured in Likert scale. So, matlab 5 point, it was 5.7 point. What matlab, I saw that it was the numerical data. I think matlab, when the answer
that's why you have mean below 5 na. 4 and 3 is below 5, right?
No, sir. My question is different. Motivation, it was written in the slide that motivation we have measured in terms of Likert scale, on Likert scale.
Okay.
So when we applied this tool, मुझे सिर्फ ये देखना है कि वो न्यूमेरिक वो ही था ना लिकर्ट स्केल को किससे अपन ने मेजर करा था मतलब 5.6 या
7.5 पॉइंट स्केल नॉट 5 पॉइंट लिकर्ट स्केल ओके एनीवे टेल मी
ओके 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 ओके
5 पॉइंट स्केल मींस आउट ऑफ 5
ओके अंडरस्टूड अंडरस्टूड दैट्स व्हाई द डेटा कम्स अंडर 2.5 3.5
लिकर्ट स्केल व्हाट इज द प्रॉब्लम टेल मी No, you will have to use some scale, na? You can use Likert scale also for motivation.
No. Okay, okay, sir. Samajh gayi. Understood.
Understood?
Yes.
Yeah, guys, any other questions on independent sample street test?
And you also said ki if variances are equal, then we take the first row. And if variances are not equal, then we take second
row. Only from here.
Yes.
From T onwards, whether you should see the first row or second row is dependent on this value. If this value is less than 0.05, you go with the second table.
Second row. Yes.
Second row. If this value is more than 0.05, you go with the
first row. Done.
Any questions, please? Okay. Then quickly let us get into independent samples t-test. So why do we use a dependent sample t-test? It is a single sample, but measurement is taken twice. That is before and after. So generally before the training program and after the training program. Before the exercise, after the exercise. Before the diet, after the diet. Before administration of a drug, etc. And here we got an example that to see whether the, you know, the mu 1 is equal to mu 2. Here mu 1 and mu 2 are not representing two different populations. It is the same population before the treatment and after the treatment. Mu 1 is equal to mu 2 means what? Treatment had no effect. That means before I gave the diet plan, the average weight was 60 kg. Even after the diet plan, the weight remains 60 kg. That means this diet plan has not worked. So it can also be stated as mu D, that is mu difference is zero. And alternate hypothesis, mu 1 is not equal to mu 2 or mu D is not equal to zero. That means treatment had an effect. So here we have an example. There are 40 students. Their scores have been measured before and after a tutorial. That means first they were all given an exam and everybody's scores are noted. And after that they were given the tutorial, and after the tutorial their scores are noted again. So now let us go to the spaces. So here you have the student, then the score before tutorial and score after tutorial. The student is identified with maybe number 1, 2, 3, 4. And remember, this is only one sample. I don't have two companies here. I don't have two organizations. You can see this is student 1, 2, 3, 4, like that up to 40 students are there. And for each student, what is the score before tutorial and what is the score after tutorial have been noted. And now the idea is to see whether the average before the tutorial is same as the average after the tutorial in the population. For that we have the data of a sample of 40 students. So to run the dependent sample t-test, we go to analyze, then compare means, then this time go to paid sample t-test. Remember, we don't have anything called dependent sample t-test in SPSS language. It is one sample, then independent sample, and then paid sample. Click on paid sample t-test. నీ దగ్గర ఉంది కదా నీ సాజర్ లేదు Yeah, so let's go ahead with the paid sample t-test. Struck somewhere or what? Yeah. So here we go. Then take a score before tutorial and score after tutorial. See, actually in a environment like this, you can have more than 2-3 pairs that can also be tested, but we have only a single pair. Then go to options. As it is, you can leave this. speak, okay? Now it is showing you the means, the score before, you know, tutorial was 51, and the score after the tutorial is 54. So you see there is a change of 4, but is it significantly large enough is what we need to test. Then it is also giving you the correlation between the two scores, that is before tutorial and after tutorial. So if the correlation is high, it only indicates that the treatment had equally affected all the respondents. So it's not that for one fellow the score has improved and for the another fellow the score has decreased. So a high correlation is an indication that it was in one direction. That is it. Now here, equality of variances need not be assumed because it is the same population. And see, the mean is -3. This is what is called the mu d. The difference is -3. Then the most important thing, look at the significance. So that is your p value. So p value is much below 0.05. So your conclusion would be to reject H0 at 5% level of significance and conclude that yes, the tutorial had an impact. Any questions? Any questions on paired sample t-test? Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now what we'll do, just I've been speaking more today. Just give me some 5 minutes break. In the meantime, just review your own understanding of t-test. Maybe we'll meet after 5-7 minutes. Then I'll take you through, I think, see, ANOVA is something similar to this. So what I propose is we will skip ANOVA and then I'll take you through discriminant analysis, because for discriminant analysis, I need to give a little tutorial for you before I get into the SPSS. Is that okay? ANOVA you can manage based on this, right?
Okay, sir.
Yeah. So now just take a 5 minutes break, then we'll assemble back and I'll take you through the, what you call, discriminant analysis.
अंडरलाइन कर रहा है मुश्किल शब्द
Yeah, guys, you are back. Shall we start?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So now I'll quickly take you through the concept of discriminant analysis, about which we already had a little bit of hint yesterday. then I'll take you through the how you run the discriminant analysis and how you interpret the output of SPSS. So we know that the requirements of building a regression model, that both the dependent and independent variables should be metric, right? That means that your dependent variable and all your independent variables should have been measured on a numerical scale. Let us consider that you would like to measure the relationship between examination performance and preparation for that examination. Right? There are, let us say, two variables in this study. One is dependent variable and other is independent variable. So exam performance and preparation for the exam. If you want to run a regression model, the examination performance should be worked out as a number, say between 0 and 100. Similarly, examination preparation should also be as a number. Let us say it is the number of hours of preparation. In case your examination performance was measured as grades, instead of measuring it as the number of marks, you measured as grades, A, B, or C grades. And the exam preparation was measured as low, medium, or high. Then you all know that you can't run a regression, right? As these variables are non-metric. But in certain cases, it is not possible to measure the variables on a metric scale. That is one reason why you go for a discriminant analysis. So what do we do? How do we model the relationship when our variables are non-metric? That means they are not measured on the nomination scale. So discriminant analysis is available where a set of metric independent variables and a categorical dependent variable is the situation. That means the dependent variable should be categorical and all independent variables should be numerical. So the dependent variable should be categorical, all independent variables shall be metric. So if you look at the records of credit card customers of a bank, you might have this data: age, number of years in the current job, number of years in the current residence, the average salary for last 3 years. So you have a reason to believe that these are your independent variables, and all these variables will explain whether a customer defaults on his payment or not. Let us say this is the model behind the assumption behind the model. Okay, so this is a fit case for discriminant analysis. So this is exactly used in the industry, that when you apply for a credit card loan, when you apply for a home loan, sometimes you get a message that your loan or credit card application is accepted. Sometimes it is rejected. Basically, they use a discriminant analysis to decide on this. And this is one of the most widely used classification techniques in the business analytics. Right? Let us get into an example without wasting much of our time. Yeah, maybe you can look at some examples. So if you look at the credit card data, right, the customer default, that is yes or no, is dependent, and it is dependent on a set of independent metric variables, age, number of years. Remember, all independent variables are numbers, and dependent variable is a category, yes or no. Similarly, it could be success of a candidate in a job interview, could be another example. So here, the dependent variable could be whether he's selected for the job or not, and there are a set of independent metric variables. Now, similarly, the grade of a student in an examination, whether he'll get an A grade, B grade, C grade, may be dependent on number of hours of preparation, marks in the qualifying examination, and marks in the internal assessment. This example I was giving yesterday. Now, let us take this example forward, and then let us get into, the discriminant analysis. So the idea is, given the independent variables, will I be able to predict the grade of the student? Right? Let us get into the spaces. Example. So here you look at the data. So we have the result of the student as 1, 2, 3. We'll just let you know by going to variable view what this result is categorized into. So here the result is categorized as the nominal variable 0 and 1. That means the student has failed or has passed in the examination, right? So now we are arguing this is dependent on, and first and foremost, you understand this is a categorical variable, right? And we are arguing that this is dependent on 3 metric variables. That's where you see the numeric variables, qualifying examination, right? Then internal examination score, and of course, number of hours of preparation. These are our 3 independent variables, which are useful in predicting whether a student will pass or fail in the examination. So that is the agenda. Now let us see how do we go about doing this. We go to analyze. Then go to classify, then go to discriminate. This is the screen you should remember. Go to analyze, then a classification, then discriminant analysis. Then it is asking about the grouping variable and independent variables. See, here the grouping variable is the dependent variable, like you have seen in a dependent sample t-test. Take the result as grouping variable and define its range. We have 0 and 1. So 0 means fail, 1 means pass. That's how the data has been coded, that is 0 and 1, and then continue. Then you take the 3 independent variables into the independence dialog box one by one, or you can actually use a shift key to push all the 3 at one time. Then you look at what other options that we have, right? Go to statistics. So and to make this simple, I am just leaving it with the default. Then go to classify. So here you can actually select the summary table where you will get the, case processing summary, etc. Then click on save and see if we can get some inputs available. Otherwise, just click OK. And this is the the thing you see here. You observe that there are 500 records in that. Right, we don't have any case processing issues. That means we don't have missing values, etc. Right, now you see how many students failed in the examination, 142, and how many students passed in the examination, 358. Then you see for the failed candidates, the individual 3 variables, weights have been given. They just to tell you there are 2 groups. One is pass group and other is fail group. Then we go to the most important part of the analysis. So this is called eigenvalues, or the the first part of the summary of canonical discriminant functions. See, it will show you the canonical discriminant functions, here it is showing only one function because you have two groups, that is pass or fail. If you have three groups, it will show you two functions, etc. That is one thing that you will have to observe. Now let us look at the eigenvalue, that's 5.947. See, the eigenvalue, the rule of thumb is if it is more than one, in which case our it is very much way above one, right? The discriminant functions are definitely very much different. That means pass group has got one characteristics, one set of characteristics, and fail group has got another set of characteristics. Right, this is what is given by the eigenvalue interpretation. So if it is close to one or less than one, we should be worried that our function is not able to discriminate between pass versus fail groups, because it's almost six. The discriminant function that has been developed by SPSS is powerful. It knows the characteristics of fail students and characteristics of pass students. Then looking at the canonical correlation, which is 0.925 here, it is like our multiple correlation in our normal, multiple regression. If you have had an idea of multiple regression, you might be knowing the concept of multiple correlation. And most important is the multiple correlation square, which we call R square. R square is also called coefficient of determination, which tells us by what extent the independent variables explain the variance in the dependent variable. So if you have known the concept of R square, what you see here in discriminant analysis is something similar to what is R in the multiple regression analysis. And now it appears to be really quite high, that is 0.925 is quite high as R. And if you take R square, it's almost 0.85, right? 0.925 into 0.925, it's almost 0.85. R square is pretty strong. That means the discriminant function is really good. But this is an indirect way of interpreting, just looking at the eigenvalues table. But a direct way of interpreting is through what is called as Wilks lambda. See, Wilks lambda is the converse of R square. That means 1 minus R square is Wilks lambda. So that's where you see it as 0.144. So in multiple regression, we would always expect a very high R square if we want our model to be really good enough. So if your model to be really good enough, then Wilks lambda should be close to zero. Like there, you are expecting R square close to one. Here it has to be close to zero, right? So this 1.144 is nothing but 0.921 minus 0.925 whole square. So that's where you get it as 0.144. So meaning that your discriminant function is really good. So smaller the values of Wilks lambda, they indicate greater discriminatory ability of the function. So we know that R square is the total variability explained. So by that count, Wilks lambda is the total variability that is not explained by the independent variables. Right? So the proportion of total variability not explained being very, very low, close to zero, indicates that yes, this has got good discriminatory power. And you will also see the significance value being less than 0.05 means that the discriminant model that is developed by this solution is really good. Then we'll get into the standardized canonical discriminant functions. The standardized canonical discriminant functions are same as your beta values in multiple regression. So you understand the beta values in multiple regression as values that give you the relative importance of the independent variables. See, here we have three variables which we thought are useful in predicting the pass or fail of a student. And you see, out of these three variables, the internal exam with 0.648 is the most important predictor. That means the internal exam has got more influence on whether a student is getting passed or failed, followed by qualifying examination, followed by the number of hours of preparation, right? So the standardized canonical discriminant coefficients are like your what you call the beta values of the multiple regression. Then you go to the structure matrix. The structure matrix gives you the discriminant functions, but they are not the standardized ones. These are like your B values, right? So in both the cases, either you use the structure matrix or use the standardized canonical discriminant function to arrive at the relative importance of the variables, they will tend to give the same result. If you observe the internal exam, there was the first one to have more impact. Here also the internal exam is 0.644, followed by qualifying examination 0.589, followed by hours of preparation. Then if you want to really build your this is what is called function set group centroids. That means if you take the discriminant function score, like you have a multiple regression equation, y is equal to a plus b1 x1 plus b2 x2 plus b3 x3, you will also have a discriminant equation. Substituting the values of x1, x2, x3, you get the value of y. If this value of y happened to be close to minus 3.86, this fellow is most likely to fail. And if it is close to 1.533, this fellow is most likely to pass. This is how you do the prediction. So this is the logic used by your credit card companies, then home loan banks, etc., to decide whether you fall in the fail category. That means whether you fall in the default category or no default category. And if you are using the same discriminant function to classify the already existing group membership, you get this in the classification results. The discriminant function that is developed by this particular methodology is 100% safe, and it is 100% results it is giving. But that means if a person has failed, actually it shows as failed. If a person has passed, it shows as passed. This means what? If you apply it in the future data, on the future data, it gives almost 100% prediction. So if the model predicts some fellow is going to fail, naturally is going to fail. So that is the meaning of classification result. I think I'll stop here and take questions on discriminant analysis. Any doubts that you have? Any questions? So no questions?
So my question is not related to this one. I understood whatever you talked today.
Okay.
But my question is different. It is a very basic one.
Doesn't matter. Tell me.
Sir, in paper, according to variable,
मेरा अभी भी वहीं पे अटक रही हूँ सर, वो नॉन पैरामेट्रिक में ही मेरा दिमाग अभी भी कल जैसे तो अगर जैसे वेरिएबल एसोसिएशन निकालना हो हमें, इफ वी वांट टू फाइंड आउट द एसोसिएशन बिटवीन द वेरिएबल, तो हमने एक वेरिएबल में तो नॉन पैरामेट्रिक लगा दिया एसोसिएशन का, और दूसरे में अगर हमको एज पर सिचुएशन जब हम मेल फीमेल या फिर एनोवा लगाना चाहे, तो मतलब एक ही उसमें हम एसोसिएशन भी फाइंड आउट कर सके एनोवा भी फाइंड आउट कर सकते हैं क्या? ऐसा हो सकता है? इज इट पॉसिबल? इट इज बेस्ड ऑन द डेटा.
No, no. Based on the data, to find out association, you have two techniques. One is chi-square, and the other is correlation.
Correlation.
This is basically to see whether two variables are related. That means whether they have some correlation or whether they have some association.
Ji.
So when variables are categorical, you use chi-square and call that there is association. The wording is also, it is association. When variables are metric, you do a correlation and say there is a relation. Instead of association, when variables are metric, for correlation we say there is a relation. Okay.
Yes.
But the t-test and ANOVA are tests for comparing two populations or two.
Yes.
Treatments, two countries, two regions, two effects. So there it's not
about,
rather there it is variable is same. Employment rate in India, employment rate in Germany. There we are not talking about any association. Whether employment rate in India is different from employment rate in Germany. Whether inflation in India is different from inflation in Sweden. So in case of a t-test, whether it is one sample, two sample, or an ANOVA, which is one way ANOVA, the variable is one only, but conditions are different. These conditions are called population, the populations. You got it now? See, you want to compare the literacy, any variable between male and female, then you use t-test. Okay.
Yes, but yeah. I frame objective. I frame two kind of objective. One is based on association, and one is based on mean difference.
See, to decide the test, don't talk about objectives. You talk about hypothesis. You break your objective, convert your objective into hypothesis, and tell me what are the variables. Then tell me. Are you having any independent dependent relationship among these variables, and then tell me what you are looking for, what is the question, then you can decide the test. Yesterday I have told you that OHVT matrix, you remember?
Yes.
You will have to have that full details before you decide the test.
Okay.
What is your hypothesis, what are your variables, how they are measured, and what is that you are looking for? Only when you know this, then you can decide about a test.
Okay.
So if you want to decide about the test, put your question into that that four columns. Is that clear?
Yes, sir. But in many theses, I saw ki. There is a non-parametric chi-square, and another thing on the basis of variable they applied ANOVA. So these two things are different for me. So मतलब मैं पूछना चाह रही हूँ कि इकट्ठे इन लोगों ने variable को देख के लगाया है कि मतलब एक parametric जा रहा है और एक non-parametric जा रहा है, तो मैं थोड़ी confused हो गई.
See, it depends on the measurement of the variable. Variable may be same. If it is measured on a categorical scale, then you have to go for non-parametric. But if it is measured on a numerical scale, then you can go with parametric.
Yes, done.
So it's very simple. Wherever you put that into that four questions. If you answer four questions, the fifth question, which is what test is to be used, gets automatically answered.
Yes.
Yeah.
Done.
Good. Any other questions, guys? Yeah, see, we thought of giving you these three lectures. My idea was different, that I didn't want to go through that, drumming the same beat and just showing you these techniques. But I just wanted to pump a little bit of thinking in all of you. So I took a different approach. This is how I normally engage my classes wherever I go. I want participants to invest their time, think, make a mistake, doesn't matter, then come back, and then there will be some confusion going back and forth. So, but then ultimately you will enjoy this. I think the recordings will be made available to you. You go through them again and again and just get into, try to pick up certain perspectives into that. Otherwise, this T, ANOVA, etc., you just get into Google, all the, material is available there. So for that, we need not have these sessions. These sessions should basically question the existing protocol, question the existing way of looking at things, and then you should develop a different thinking, because it's going to be a lifelong research for you. So that was the motive with which I have conducted my three-day session, slightly differently than what you would have expected me to do. Hope that had made sense. And if you have no questions, we will close. Yeah, Urvashi, I am done. If participants have some questions, we can take. Otherwise, we can.
Okay, sir. Thank you. So, any participant can has any query, any doubt, kindly ask to sir.
Ma'am, I have sir has solved my all the queries, so I don't have any question.
Any one of you, except Priyanka, ma'am. Any one of you, if you want to ask anything from sir. Okay, so the silence says that no one has no queries. So thank you so much, sir. Before starting the vote of thanks, the session vote of thanks, I would like to request Dr. Khushbu ma'am and Dr. Yala sir kindly on your camera, so the session will be live.
So, just a second then.
Okay, sir, okay.
It should be okay now, right? Not in a proper.
Good evening, sir. Very good evening. Nice to see you, sir. Thank you, sir. And Dr. Khushbu, ma'am, please.
Yes, I too will.
Dr. Malti, ma'am, you have, ma'am, with us?
Hello.
Hello, Dr. Khushbu. Dr. Malti, ma'am.
Yes, I've joined. One second, let me again on my camera.
If any participant wants to on your camera.
Participants,
kindly on your camera.
We can also have the other participants switching on their cameras, so that this being the last day, we that's good to see faces. Most of us have been unknown entities.
Yes.
The offline, the online mode has this disadvantage. Yeah.
Hello, Dr. Priyanka. Nice to see you, ma'am, once again in our DIAS FDP.
Okay. I think I would again like to thank Dr. Irala, sir, and Khushbu for taking out time and again addressing all the participants. We hope that there have been a lot of takeaways from these sessions. And we just hope that you end up building on what you have learned. Because most of the times what happens is that unless and until we go and practice and we go and do things which are taught, it would not be again fruitful. So everything depends on the extent of practice that we do. So we just hope that you've had a lot of takeaways from the session, and this would be helpful in your future research also. So happy learning to all of you. And once again, thank both the resource persons for sharing their knowledge with all the participants. And we hope to have people participating and learning on a continuous basis. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Urvashi, for
connecting us with such a good audience. They were like sincere and obedient students throughout.
And sometimes were reprimanded also.
Right. Even then they followed well. They also deserve a round of applause.
Yes. All the participants who have joined us, and Urvashi has been again quite resourceful, and then she's taken and the participants through these sessions quite effectively. So a big round of applause for Urvashi also, and for all the participants who have joined us from various places. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Urvashi. Yeah. Thank you, everybody.
Sincere thanks to both of our resource person, Dr. Khushbu ma'am and Dr. Irala sir. Thank you to give us a very practical knowledge. Even the content of that particular FDP is very theoretical, even though. So such a very knowledgeable and practicable sessions all we have. And Dr. N. Malathi ma'am, seriously, thanks to you for your constant support. Thank you, ma'am. And thanks to all participants. Thank you very much. So have a nice evening. And
guys, stay in touch and please take good care of yourself.
Yes, everyone. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. And we hope to see some of you in the advanced section too.
Yes, from tomorrow onwards. Okay.
Yeah. So everyone, thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Bye. Take care.
Bye.
So participants, please fill your feedback form. So I will be able to send you the e-certificate on the behalf of your feedback details. I'll send you the certificates, because many participants has confusion during the registration. So it's my request, those participants send me the feedback only get the e-certificate. Okay. I have sent that feedback link to all of you. Please fill as soon as possible so I am able to give you the e-certificate on time.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, sir. Okay, so you all may leave the meeting. Thank you, everyone.